Presentation on the test steps to secure API. Now we will move to the next segment of the connected apps theme technical stage, in which I would like to now invite Rohit Saxena, software development consultant and Guardian Life. And he will be sharing something really interesting, which I think is also teased down well with both the session which we had earlier from standardizing the financial account aggregation and then 10 steps to securing your APIs. Now, this session will cover the asynchronous and broadcasting APIs using Kafka. So with that note, would like to welcome Rohit. Rohit, a very warm welcome to API Days Live India. And we are all here excited to know more about your session as well as going a bit deep dive. Any questions that will be related to your session, we will take at the end of your session. So,
yeah, sure. Thank you, Dheeraj. I'm also excited to speak here. So, am I visible and my slides are visible?
Yes, all good.
Okay, sure. Thank you. So, before starting, first of all, I want to thank you, the API Days teams, to giving me this opportunity to put my thoughts here. Okay, so before starting my topic, I want to introduce myself. So, my name is Rohit Saxena, and I'm having around 11 years of industry experience till now. So till now, I've worked mainly in the companies like Fidelity, Yatra, Valvoline, and Guardian Life till now. And here I will be covering the topic about that how we can build the asynchronous and broadcasting APIs using Kafka and how it got evolved and what is the future scope of these kind of APIs are there. So I will not waste any other time and directly move to the our agenda. So our agenda, we will cover that how this all got started, where do we come from the monolithic to this path, how we got the microservices, then why we should use asynchronous API, and within the asynchronous API, what can we do even better within the asynchronous API, and while implementing the event-driven API, how does Apache Kafka help there, and also within the event-driven APIs, when it comes about streaming, about data analytics or broadcasting, how the Kafka streaming helps there. And at last, we will just have a go through what is the summary of conclusion of my these topics, and then we will have the Q&A. So let's start, where do we come from? If I talk about more than two decades ago, we used to have a monolithic architecture for every web application in which it have a UI and a backend and a singly bundled together application which is deployed over a server, which is interacting, might be a database or some caching against over there. But so this architecture was not having any issue till in late 90s. It was perfectly working fine. But when it comes to scalability and the availability of application, it was having major challenges. Like if any single module got any issue or error in this monolithic application, then the entire application goes down. So to getting rid of all these things later, when we evolved our software development slowly, then we come with SOA architecture over there, which was basically a service-oriented architecture. In which we, what we try to do that we layered out every layer of our development in terms of service layer, business layer, DAO layer, and every layer, so that we can segregate the layer based on its purpose within the software development. But it does not mean that it solved all the problems over there. It's just giving a clear visibility to the developers and the people who want to understand the software development, a clear visibility that how the layers are segregated, what is the purpose of each layer, and what it will do. But still the challenges were there because the tight coupling was there. Because like every service, all the services are bundled together. So then when we come out in starting of 2000 series, the concept of microservices came into picture. And what happened? So like you started decomposing your modules or features, not into a single application. You started creating a small independent application as a microservices, which you can divide on a different basis. Like there are different design patterns available. The famous one is like domain-driven design, or you can divide it on the business-wise. So based on the design pattern suits your requirement, you can easily divide your microservices. That suppose if you're designing for some e-commerce thing, obviously there will be some microservices for customer, some for product, some for order, some for stock management, and other one will be for like for payment, for authentication. So in this thing, we try to approach, we got some goals like apart from the SOA, now every microservice is able to run independently. Failure of one microservice is not impacting other ones over there. But still, it was a tight coupling between the client interaction and the server. Like when the client will ask for something, which service need to respond with what response, and it should be immediate. By immediate, I mean the synchronous API. So how did this all work? I will show you in my next slide. But the problem still was there. It was a tight coupling between the end-to-end. Like the request and response was predefined that this client will hit this request at this particular URL, and this server endpoint need to give the response immediately whenever the request come. So this architecture was still having some issue, like the because of the load. Suppose we are having a billions of hit on some particular endpoint at the same time over there, and due to some capability limitation, basically our backend system is able to serve only few at a time, not all at a time. So there are chances it may overload of the service, it may cause a slow response time also, it may crash also over there. And still it is not so extensible. Suppose if we are already running one system with the four microservices over there, and we keep adding the other services over there, but still it was a tight coupling. We need to change the existing code also, then only you can make the tight end-to-end coupling over there. So to solving all of these things, what we think, first of all, what is the difference between synchronous and asynchronous? Then I will tell you why asynchronous we should use. So what happened in the synchronous API, as you can see, there is a client and there is a server. So client makes a request to the server, and it has to wait for the response until the time the server is taking time to process that request for giving is the response. Till that time, the client is waiting over there. But what happened in the asynchronous API, it simply makes the request and continues working whatever it wants to do. And whenever the processing is complete, server gives a notification with the response that what it did with the request. It may be a success, it may be a failure over there. But so how it is beneficial? Let's take an example. We are hitting a single request over there, and in that request it need to hit the 10 further hits downstreams, which each takes around 100 milliseconds over there. So for getting when from the time we got the initial request and we are hitting the 10 API or 10 services downstreams, each take is 100 milliseconds. So overall, once the server will give the response to the client, it will take 1 second. It means like 1,000 milliseconds over there. But if we are using the same structure in the asynchronous API concept and the initial request only, it will hit 10 asynchronous APIs at a single time, and all will run parallelly, and all will take 100 milliseconds. So overall total response time will be 100 milliseconds only with respect to 1 second in the synchronous API case. We understand the same thing with another example, where the time is not constant for all the downstream systems. So suppose in this one synchronous request, the downstream systems the first one takes 20 seconds, second takes 7 seconds, third take 10 seconds, and fourth take 8 seconds. So the sum of these seconds are 45 seconds. So when the client will get the response, it will get the response in 45 seconds. But when I talk about the asynchronous APIs, all will execute in the parallel, and the total response time will be equal to the maximum time taken by any downstream system. So maximum time is 20 seconds. So in the meanwhile, all of the requests will also get completed. So we will get the overall response in 20 seconds. So this is the benefit. And why we should use asynchronous API, and what is the benefit and what is the type? So let's discuss now. So we should use asynchronous API because there are scenarios. I am giving you 5 examples around. So there are scenarios where some request you got, but the request processing, whatever you want to do, is going to take a long time. Maybe it can be uploading a video, it can be encoding or analyzing a big data set. It's going to take some time over there. Or maybe you want to perform some kind of analytics event over there, and that API is not able to give the immediate response over there. So that is not immediately available over there. Or also, you want to react on some data events. Like if you give you an example, like in the Uber, the cabs keep giving you its location via the GPS as they change their location. So you want your app to react on the changes of data. So in all these scenarios, the synchronous API is not gonna work. You have to build the asynchronous API. That will be the lifesaver over there. And in these 3 contexts, so we can say there are 3 kind of asynchronous API we can build. First will be for the task management, which is responsible for handling a big task, which is going to take time in processing the request. Second will be the event flow, where you are having a stream of events, and the events will keep coming in a stream, and you will keep processing and giving the outputs, whatever is required. And third will be the push API. So like it is getting, keep pushing you the notifications, and you want to react on the data changes over there. So how we gonna implement these three asynchronous API, the task management, event flow, and push API. So for implementing, the technologies we are having are as follows. So the task management can be implemented via a queue. It can be a messaging queue, or it can be a Kafka model like Kafka also. So in this, the event, we will get the events on, we will get a task one by one in the queue, and as soon as we get the task in the queue, the application the server side application pick that task and process that task and give the response over there. And this all is asynchronous, so whatever is dropping the task, just drop the task and continue its working, and whenever the server complete this processing and give back the response to the client over there. And when it comes to the events, so it will keep getting the real-time data events over there. It can be, and it will be processing all the stream data in chunks. So like as we use, as you must have heard in the SQL, the batch processing. So it is something similar to it. The Kafka stream use the concept of windowing. It uses a window size to process the chunks of a stream to take at a time and process it over there. And the push API is kind of a simple a message broker thing. So whatever services want to drop a notification, it will simply push, and whoever is subscribed to that particular topic or that particular event, that will get a notification and do the needful for it over there. So when we have this type of asynchronous API, so it can be implemented via any of these technologies. Like we can use any MQ, like RabbitMQ or like Amazon Secure over there, the Kafka, Spark Streaming, these all things we use. But today we will understand only how Kafka can help us here. So we already discussed in the last diagram that how the microservices were segregated from a monolithic application. But now we are talking about asynchronous API, which is event-driven among the microservices. So as you can see from the front end, it can be any web or it can be any Android application. Whenever any request comes to any APIs, maybe API gateway will be there, which will redirect to the required server. Required microservice, it will redirect. But whatever processing is required among the microservices is there. There is no tight coupling that this service will call any service directly. There will be an event hub in place, and whatever this service will just simply drop whatever event it wants to trigger. And whoever is listening out of these microservices, this particular event, they will get the message and they will process it. And again, they will give the response to this event hub. So everything is configured in this event hub. Who want to push the notification, who want to get the notification. It will be, so in this way, there's a loose coupling over there, and we can also easily play with domain-driven design here. But for implementing this event-driven design among the microservices, what will implement this event hub? Who will play this role? So for that, Apache Kafka will help. How it will help, then I will show you in the next diagram, but first understand in very brief what is actually Apache Kafka. So Apache Kafka is a message broker. It was initially a project which is built in LinkedIn, then it is also as an open source project as Apache Kafka. So it is a message broker which is based on PubSub model, mean publisher and subscriber model. So you can see here, it always, for maintaining the high availability and no failure, it always work in a cluster. So that in a cluster, multiple Kafka booker work at a time. Normally, recommended size is 3, and you can increase and decrease as per your convenience over there. So there are producers over there and the consumers. So producers are which entity which publish the messages on to trigger the events over there, and consumers are the entity who is subscribed to that particular events over there. And to subscribe or produce the event, there is an entity we call it as topic. So this is that predefined entity which we can use to differentiate at what event it will listen and what event it will subscribe over there. So that we call as a topic over there. And then we need to use the schema registry. When we go further defining the messages over there, that what on a particular topic, what kind of message it's gonna get over there. And so these kind of things Apache Kafka hold, and it is giving you like a long retention period of about 7 days, which is by default, which you can change over there. And but only the challenges features are there in Kafka that if you talk about the failure handling of Kafka, once you get any message and you try to process it, if you fail it, so that thing you need to try your own some mechanism, although it is having giving you some mechanism to retry the consumer after some particular time, but you need to you may need to handle a few kind of things like you may need to go into some additional retry that is sending the message to the data view if it is not being successful at all. So let's understand this example, which is very much similar to the concept of design of Uber. So let's discuss this diagram completely. So there can be n number of modules and features which is having in different functionalities and different features in terms of microservices, which can be a CRM or which can be an management tool over there. And these are the real-time entities which is triggering the events. So like it can be a cabs, which is triggering the location event at each frequent intervals, maybe some milliseconds, by giving its exact location where it is. The mobile apps, the person trying to book the cab or to track a particular ride, to track the weather data, to tell us how much time is not taken one particular ride over there. And there can be some other kind of social media events to track the driver and customer, both the things can be there. So these complete boxes keep generating the events at a particular interval over there, and this will keep generating the stream events over there. As I told you, there will be event hub. So this event hub can be a Kafka cluster over there, and this event hub will be continuously listening to all kind of events which is coming either from admin panel or from real time events over there. And now, since all of these are the subscriber to this event hub, so that this is our microservices cluster, which will have n number of microservices based on our user model. They can be like driver service, customer service, driver service, rider service, location service, and booking service. So there can be a number of services over here which can listen to these events, whatever data is coming over there, and perform some action and do the needful for it for that purpose over there. And also after processing this data, there can be some and users like our website of Uber or the mobile app of user, which we want to have the consolidated data after the thing, that how much time my ride will arrive, how much time it's going to take to complete a ride. So this kind of stress it's going to deliver here also. However, since it is completely asynchronous, after getting an event in the event hub, all these three boxes are working in a parallelly and in an independent manner and in an asynchronous way. So it's not going to impact the performance of each other, that everyone is trying to get the parallel, all the stream processing events and process it together. So everything is, this microservice cluster do its part, and there will be a stream processing cluster, which will having the Kafka streams part, which keep analyzing these streams over there and keep giving the some analytics data to all these BI tools over there, that suppose that how many cabs are available right now for your location. So it keeps showing you those kind of graphs over there. And because every analytics is a big need nowadays for the real-time data in every organization. So there will be a cluster for the tools, like the big data or Hadoop for the data analytics tool, but for collecting the data in a storage over there, maybe it is a raw data or after some refinement data, it is keep collecting the data, the real-time data via this data flow over there, and is keep evolving this storage or storage in the parallel, and these kind of tools keep doing the parallel processing to refine the raw data in a refined storage and to show you the results, which you can later on export to your data warehouse for some purposes over there. So this kind of how it helps here in this case. So if we talk about the conclusion basically over there, so it's we are not saying that this for every kind of API and for every kind of communication the asynchronous is a better fit, but yes, and most of the scenarios where it is not an immediate need to have a synchronous API and to make the client wait for getting the immediate response, surely you can divide out the request into the pattern, that your request is coming into the command pattern, event pattern, or queries pattern, and based on that you can need to take the decision that you want to have a synchronous API or a synchronous API. And also, like if you think nowadays even for the payments. We started later on, I think few years back, it was a mentality then, like for a booking some kind of products or booking a flight ticket, we used to have a asynchronous API and we keep showing the loading bar to the client that meanwhile we are booking the flight for him and doing the payment service and generating the ticket. But now everything is asynchronous. Yeah, the client just books the thing and we simply say the client with a user-friendly message, let right now we are processing your transaction. So we will notify you once it is successful, once it is processed. And meanwhile, in the back end, we do so many events like we book the ticket, we generate a ticket, make the payment, and notify the customer in a few milliseconds or seconds that your transaction has been done successfully. You got the tickets in your mail or here are your tickets and everything you have handed over there. And when it comes to asynchronous API, you have to make sure that you are choosing the right kind of tool to make asynchronous API, whether it is for handling a task or it is for handling some event or you want to get push some notification. So you should use the right tool to create your asynchronous APIs over there. And when you come to building the event-driven APIs over there, so I'm sure like the Apache Kafka is a very good solution which can provide in both scenarios where you are having process one message at a time. So simply Kafka publish subscribe model over a single message gonna work over there. And when you are having a source of a stream over there, so Kafka stream gonna work is over there.
Thank you so much, Rohit, for an amazing session. And I'm sure because there are a lot many questions that comes across as part of this session. And I think Apache Kafka, like you shared, offers a scalable event streaming platform with which you can build applications around the powerful concept and events. And by using events as the basis for connecting your applications and services, and you benefit in many ways.
Because as per the research, already by 2020, more details you can connect me either so, LinkedIn or my mail, and I think LinkedIn I am very active, so I can reply. So now I think I'm open to any questions.
Sure. So we do have a quick question from the audience, Rohit. So Arjun Pawar has a question in which he elaborates for asynchronous API. You have mentioned that response time would be the time which was taken by task who take maximum time in execution. So his question is that why it is considering the time which was taken by task who take maximum time, why not the time which was taken by task who take least time?
Yeah, because the thing is that suppose if I give take an example, the same, you are trying to book a flight over there and you are having 2-3 services. So like one service generates the ticket, one service make the payments, and one service do something else. But before sending the final response to the client or customer that your booking has been successful and here is your tickets, you need to perform all your subtasks. Then only you can revert them to the client. So suppose if the payment service is taking less time and ticket generation service is taking a little bit more time, like payment service is taking 20 milliseconds and generate ticket service is taking 30 milliseconds. So you will give the notification via SMS or mail at a single time to the consumer that here is booking is successful, here are your tickets. So you have to wait until the service is taking more time, that is also get completed. Then only you give a single response over there.
Right. Thanks for answering. Thanks for answering that, Rohit. And Arjun, I hope that your questions have been answered. And if you have any follow-up question, please feel free to drop in the chat box as well. Message directly to Rohit, who is available on chat as well. And at the same time, again, I would like to really appreciate, Rohit, what you have shared, because I think as part of the uses of the APIs of Kafka and its surrounding ecosystem, and in fact, we have Mark from Confluent, who will be elaborating a bit more on the Apache Kafka, because I think including the both subscription-based consumption as well as key value lookups against materialized views without the need for additional data stores are definitely a more of our uses around the Apache Kafka, because the APIs are also available as native clients as well as over REST. So once again, Rohit, really appreciate all the time you have provided as part of this session.
Thank you.
And definitely the a huge Indian community coming from the API domain has benefited with your expertise. So once again, great thank you for being here. Hope to see you next time as well.